welcome again. Today we begin topic 4, biodiversity. As we go from section to section, we will make connections. Ultimately, we'll complete the entire syllabus, but we'll find that the entire list of topics that we cover are all connected, very much like the spider's web. In today's lesson, we begin with definitions of the terms biodiversity, genetic diversity, species diversity, and habitat diversity. We outline the mechanism of natural selection as a possible driving force for speciation. And 4.1.3, we state that isolation can lead to different species being produced that are unable to interbreed to yield fertile offspring. And finally, 4.1.4, we explain how plate activity, plate tectonics, has influenced evolution and biodiversity. Biodiversity, the amount of biological or living diversity per unit area. It includes the concepts of species diversity, habitat diversity, and genetic diversity. Habitat diversity refers to the range of different habitats or the number of ecological niches per unit area in an ecosystem, community, or biome. Conservation of habitat diversity usually leads to the conservation of species and genetic diversity. Let's consider the rainforest habitat. A stream flowing through the rainforest, just one part of the habitat. You can see that there are a lot of moss growing on these rocks and some shrubs growing here along the banks of the stream. And if we went up into the canopy, then we would find that there is even more biodiversity in this part of the forest. The canopy is one of the most biodiverse areas on the planet, with lots of different species making their home in the canopy. Even in one of these little epiphytic bromeliads, you can find lots of different microorganisms making their home in the water that's trapped by the bromeliad, and even frogs laying eggs in these areas and having tadpoles hatch back to the floor of the rainforest. But within this one area, you can have a lot of diversity of habitat, a lot of diversity of ecological niches. And this is just the one component of the overall thing that is biodiversity. Coastline in the Galapagos Islands. Does this qualify as an example of habitat diversity? Explain your answer. With reference to this image, explain the terms zonation and environmental gradient. Another component of biodiversity is species diversity. The variety of species per unit area. This includes both the number of species present and their relative abundance. Consider which of these two pictures would be a better representation for this definition of species diversity. Picture on the left shows many different kinds of plants in the same area, species diversity, whereas the picture on the right, all of the organisms that are clearly visible belong to the same species. And then we come to genetic diversity, the range of genetic material present in a gene pool or population of a species. And here we should recall the definition from section 2.1 of a population. With that definition in our minds, then we can consider which of these two pictures is the better representation of genetic diversity. The reason that we choose the picture of the Galapagos iguanas is because they represent a population, a group of individuals of the same species living in a given area. And within that population, you have genetic diversity. This genetic diversity, or the different forms of genes that you have that give the iguanas their skin tones and their lengths, all of these traits are brought about by different genes that are found within the population's gene pool. And this diversity of genetic material is what we call genetic diversity. So genetic diversity is a term that's applied to populations. We've got species diversity, genetic diversity, and habitat diversity. With reference to this picture, describe the meaning of the term biodiversity. Let's consider some issues that we discussed in section 2.1. This relationship here, where organisms compete with members of the same species for food and for living space. What would you call that? What are some factors that affect the primary productivity? What are some biotic and abiotic factors that affect this rabbit? How is the fox population going to affect the rabbit population? And how is the rabbit population going to affect the fox population? Negative feedback. We've had several examples in section 2.1 of negative feedback. If we assumed that the rabbits and the foxes lived in a closed system with not much interference from the outside, over thousands of years, only the fastest and strongest rabbits would escape the foxes, and only the fastest and stealthiest foxes would be able to catch the limited number of rabbits. And over a long period of time, only the fittest rabbits would survive. And this would lead the rabbit gene pool to be driven in a positive direction, where only the best genes are passed on from generation to generation. And the same force would be at work with the fox, with their gene pool improving in their struggle to survive and to catch their prey. And then if we expanded the picture to include all of the other abiotic factors and the competition from other species, then over a long period of time, we would have a stronger breed of rabbit being produced by the forces of nature selecting what traits or what genes should be passed on, and you have natural selection. We return to the Galapagos Islands, this time to study a very special example, the Galapagos iguana, Amblyrhynchus cristatus. It's a descendant, really, of an iguana that lived on the South American mainland, Iguana iguana. Once upon a time, there were iguanas living in South America, and the Galapagos Islands arose because of underwater volcanic eruptions. In time, through events like hurricanes and tornadoes, iguanas became swept away on logs, and they made the journey over to the Galapagos Islands. Most of these iguanas that got swept away did not survive the difficult journey at sea. But the very strong and resilient iguanas who did survive found a new environment on these islands. An environment that was very different from that on the South American mainland. Here, the rich green rainforest did not exist, and the only real source of food lay in the cold waters. Only the strongest iguanas were able to venture out into the cold water, to swim, and to forage on algae. Because these iguanas were able to survive on the Galapagos Islands, we say that they were able to be successful in the struggle for existence. And in being successful in the struggle for existence, only some organisms can be winners and many are losers. Only some genes are the ones favored by the environment. The best swimmers and the most resilient iguanas possessed those genes to win the struggle for existence. But most important, they were able to pass on those genes to the next generation. Because they were fit, and this fitness is being able to survive the struggle for existence and then to pass on your genes to the next generation. And with this ongoing pattern of struggling with the forces of the environment, and only the fittest iguanas being able to win the struggle and pass on their genes, over thousands of years, the South American iguana transformed itself into an iguana that today looks so different that it can no longer breed with the South American iguana. When this happens, you have a new species. And this particular type of speciation, brought about by a separation, a geographical separation, is referred to as allopatric, allo meaning apart, allopatric speciation. This being made possible because of the existence of the Galapagos Islands due to underwater volcanic activity, and then the forces of nature washing off only the fittest and the strongest iguanas to the coastline of the harsh Galapagos Islands. Over thousands of years, the forces of natural selection transforming iguana into Amblyrhynchus cristatus. Millions of years ago, all of the land masses of Earth were joined as one. And over a very long period of time, the continents on their plates drifted away. We find that similar creatures are found in this area and this area, and the fossils date to a similar time period. The areas that were first separated from the big land mass have some of the most unique kinds of flora and fauna, like the islands of Australia, New Zealand, and not to forget the island of Madagascar. These are just three areas of the planet that have very unique flora and fauna. How is this animal unique? Where is it found? And how does plate tectonics, continental drift, help explain the unique biodiversity of some regions of the Earth? Finally, we defined the term species in section 2.1 as a group of organisms that interbreed and produce fertile offspring. Ligers are hybrid animals produced by a lion father and a tiger mother. in captivity, these ligers are sometimes fertile, especially the females. Consider how this occurrence and some other similar occurrences among other species, how does this challenge our definition of a species as a group of organisms that interbreed and produce fertile offspring?